play concert presented by Canticum Novum. We are delighted to have you with us this evening, and trust that the rain stays away, the music will honor God, and we're just grateful for your presence this evening. Would you bow your heads with me? Let's ask God's blessing on our concert this evening. Heavenly Father, we're thankful tonight for the opportunity to be in this place, in such a country where we can freely assemble and communicate great truths by music. We certainly are grateful for all you've done in and through our country, through our great heritage as a country committed to personal and religious freedoms. May Christ be honored today. We're praying that there will be the clear proclamation even of the gospel of Christ this evening. Thank you for the privilege of gathering tonight. We pray your blessing upon our meeting. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand and join me in reciting the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. You may be seated. America the Beautiful was written by a young pioneer teacher, Kathleen Lee Bates. Though it was born as a poem in 1893 at the top of Pikes Peak, the seeds for this patriotic hymn were planted in the days prior to Miss Bates' trip to the mountain height. Miss Bates, a graduate of Wellesley College in Massachusetts, was asked to teach a summer session at Colorado College in Colorado Springs. Her trip west afforded her sights and sounds of a rugged and beautiful America. There was the roaring span of Niagara Falls. Then, the World's Columbian Exposition in Chicago, which included a display of the real Liberty Bell, fireworks that lit up the night sky, and an exhibition called The White City that was a prototype for future urban development. The White City featured painted marble facades that gleamed like alabaster. Finally, there was the ocean-like expanse of the golden wheat fields waving gently in the summer wind as she traveled by train across the Kansas Plains toward Colorado on July 4th, 1893. These were the memories that Miss Bates took with her when she and some of her fellow teachers from Colorado College decided to take a trip on July 22nd. Miss Bates described the event. One day, some of the other teachers and I decided to go on a trip to 14,000 foot Pikes Peak. We hired a prairie wagon. Near the top, we had to leave the wagon and go the rest of the way on mules. I was very tired, but when I saw the view, I felt great joy. All the wonder of America seemed displayed there. It was the most glorious scenery I had ever beheld. She insisted that the sublimity of the Rockies smote my pencil with despair, but she was not wordless for long. Then and there, she said, as I looked out over the sea-like expanse of fertile country spreading away under those ample skies, the opening lines of the hymn floated into my mind. Bates' hymn was placed in over 70 musical settings, but the tune that carries it best was actually composed over 10 years before Miss Bates penned her famous lines. The tune Materna was composed in 1882 by Samuel Ward, the organist at Grace Episcopal Church in Newark, New Jersey. It was discovered and joined to Miss Bates' text by a Baptist minister named Clarence Barber in 1904. Samuel Ward died in 1903, and he never knew the full reach of his composition. Ward's tune so seamlessly fits with Miss Bates' text that it is hard to conceive that they were composed independently of one another. Many have advocated that America the Beautiful should be our national anthem, and the hymn remains one of the most beloved of America's patriotic songs.
Beautiful for spacious skies, for
next song is a medley of service anthems representing the five armed services: Army, Marines, Coast Guard, Navy, and Air Force. If you are a member or have served in one of these branches, we are going to ask for your participation. When you hear your anthem announced, please stand while it is being sung. Then, when your anthem is finished, please be seated so the next branch can stand and be recognized. We are deeply indebted to each one of you for the many sacrifices you have made for us in the service and defense of your country. So it is with grateful hearts that we offer this tribute to you, the men and women of the United States military.
We're always ready to
Armed Forces. One special note I learned before the concert, that one gentleman who's with us tonight over here was a Marine who served at the Battle of Iwo Jima in World War II. If you have the opportunity to say thank you, these are veterans. Thank you. Thank you, sir. As a child, William Whiting dodged in and out of the waves as they crashed along England's shoreline. Years later, on a journey by sea, William learned the true and terrifying power of those waves. On that journey, a powerful storm blew in, so violent that the crew lost control of the vessel. During those desperate hours, as the waves roared over the deck, Whiting's faith in God helped him to stay calm. When the storm subsided, the ship, badly damaged, limped back to port. William Whiting went on to become an Anglican churchman and poet, and the experience in those hours had a galvanizing effect on him. As one hymn historian put it, Whiting was changed by this experience. He respected the power of the ocean nearly as much as he respected the God who made and controls it. The memory of this voyage allowed Whiting to provide comfort to one of the boys he taught at a training school in Winchester. One day, a young man confided that he was about to embark on a journey to America, a voyage fraught with danger at the time. The boy was filled with dread at the thought of the ordeal to come. A sympathetic Whiting described his own frightening experience, and he and the other boys prayed for the terrified student. When Whiting told him, "Before you depart, I will give you something to anchor your faith," Whiting, an experienced poet, put pen to paper and wrote a poem reminding the boys of God's power, even over the mighty ocean. Scholars believe Whiting was inspired in part by Psalm 107, which describes God's deliverance from a great storm at sea. In verses 28 and 29, we read, "Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he made the storm be still, and the waves of the sea were hushed." The hymn also clearly references the historical account of Jesus and his disciples caught in a sudden storm on the Sea of Galilee. The Gospel of Mark records that Jesus, after being awakened by his disciples, rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. This demonstration of power was clear proof that Jesus is God. In 1861, Whiting's poem was set to music by the Reverend John Dykes. The tune was named Melita, after the place of the Apostle Paul's shipwreck, recorded in Acts chapter 28. The hymn became enormously popular. British, French, and American sailors all adopted it, and it became known as the Sailor's Hymn. Winston Churchill loved it. The hymn was performed at the funerals of Presidents Franklin Roosevelt, John Kennedy, and Ronald Reagan. Because it is sung at the U.S. Naval Academy in Annapolis, it is often called the Navy Hymn. spiritual national anthem. During its passage through American history, this 18th century hymn has gained wide usage and secular popularity. And yet, the most powerful aspect of this hymn is its original meaning and purpose, to communicate the truth of God's gracious provision of forgiveness for sin. The gift of forgiveness is often best appreciated by those who need it most. The Reverend John Newton experienced this truth firsthand. His tombstone tells his story. John Newton, clerk, once an infidel and libertine, a servant of slavers in Africa, was, by the rich mercy of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, preserved, restored, pardoned, and appointed to preach the faith that he so long labored to destroy. These words, written by Newton himself, are a testimony to God's transforming power. After years as a hardened slave trader, that wretch met Jesus Christ and abruptly turned to defend the gospel he had long despised. Amazing Grace once fueled the fires of revival in the camp meetings of the Second Great Awakening and the urban ministry of D.L. Moody and Ira Sankey. America is once in need, again, of a great spiritual awakening. We protest an economy, a political establishment, and a culture in decline. We clamor for political saviors to set our economy right, to enforce a sense of justice, to defend us from our enemies and save us from moral disaster. But what we desperately need as a nation and as individuals is to gain a consciousness of God and an awareness of our sin against Him. What we really need is a personal Savior. Throughout John Newton's years of ministry, God's amazing grace remained central to his thinking. When it was suggested that he retire at age 82 due to poor health and a failing memory, he responded, "My memory is nearly gone, but I remember two things. I am a great sinner, and Christ is a great Savior." The gospel Newton championed was the good news of God's salvation and forgiveness for sinners great and small. It is the good news that though we are all sinners, Jesus Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and he was buried, and he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. It is the good news that Jesus is alive today, and it is the good news that whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Massachusetts. The scene around them was chaotic. Thousands of Union troops were marching in every street, preparing for a looming battle with soldiers from the 13 slave states that had broken away to form a new confederation. With men shouting, cursing, and shooting guns in the air, the lone woman in the coach wondered if the whole world had gone mad. As the party slowly made its way through the street, Dr. Clark noted a group of men gathered outside an inn, singing, "John Brown's body lies a moldering in the grave." Rather than inspiring the minister's patriotic spirit, the image of seeing drunken men singing about a proud man now rotting in the soil disgusted him. He glanced toward the house and declared that a tune so robust should not be coupled with words so dismal. Those around Clark nodded in agreement. In the early days of the war, the song "John Brown's Body" was wildly popular. In its original incarnation, the tune had nothing to do with a notorious abolitionist leader. It had become inextricably identified with him and acquired new verses that were sung by federal troops and Union sympathizers alike. The tune attributed to William Steff had been borrowed from an old Methodist hymn, "O Brothers, Will You Meet Us?", which spoke of the anticipation of meeting in heaven. After an hour on the unruly streets, the Howes returned to their hotel room, where they spent the remainder of the evening discussing the state of the Union. They questioned whether the drunken men that they had witnessed falling out of taverns could possibly save the country. They also wondered how many of these men would be dead by this time next year. It was a depressed Julia Howe who brushed her hair that night. As she looked at her image in the mirror, she saw the horrors of war. Although she was exhausted, she was unable to think of anything but pain and suffering. She was also unable to rid her mind of the morbid song she had heard during the carriage ride. Even after she had turned on the lamp and gone to bed, the thoughts of death and destruction and the images of young men shooting each other on smoke-filled fields raced through her mind. As her husband slept beside her, Julia began to quietly sing "John Brown's Body." At first, she mouthed the words that she had heard that afternoon, but soon, new lyrics leaped into her mind. They were words that seemed both to fit her grave mood and to sum up the sorrowful task that her nation now faced. Buoyed by this inspiration, she picked up pen and paper and attempted to compose a poem set to the cadence of "John Brown's Body." As Mrs. Howe was a very religious woman, it was hardly surprising that the words she set to paper reflected not only the conflict at hand, but her own faith. 2.5 months later, in February of 1862, the Atlantic Monthly brought Mrs. Howe's poem to the public, where it quickly became a part of the repertoire of America's most beloved patriotic songs.
was born across the sea, with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free.
This memorial was to honor those who had fought in the Battle of Gettysburg, July 1st through July 3rd of 1863, especially the 51,000 men who had become casualties of that one battle. The famed orator Edward Everett poured himself into preparing his speech for the occasion. It took him weeks to prepare and 2 hours to deliver the speech, which was over 13,000 words. President Lincoln was also asked to make an appearance and briefly address the solemn assembly. Lincoln loved the study of grammar and was laboriously precise